leading the Golden Knights, Nick.
Yeah, the Killer Bees, Doug Brisson. There's a guy that's learned to go the other way, patient at the plate, 15 home runs this year, 65 RBIs. And you got a guy in Bowser. This guy, Matt Bowser, was just invited to the Olympic trials, and he's excited about that. He's the hottest young talent since Ricky Martin.
Big game for the Knights, who have also lost 7 of their last 9 games. Well, a couple of guys getting young starts, if you will, for the Gators. Derek Devon, just his 2nd start of the year, and Bay Paul for UCF, his 1st start of the season. Those are the pitchers back for Florida and Central Florida. Coming next on Sunshine.
Oh, my back.
National anthem here at beautiful McKeithen Stadium, and it is a beautiful night for baseball, as it turned out. After all, there was a very brief, very light shower that fell about 3 hours or so ago, but both clubs took batting practice as normal on the field, and the field in excellent playing shape, as it always is here at McKeithen Stadium. And a beautiful night for baseball, that we're happy that you are with us here on Sunshine tonight. Jay Bergman, the veteran head coach of the UCF Knights. This is the way UCF will bat tonight. Matt Meat is the second baseman leading off. Mark Battier, the center fielder, hitting second. Matt Bowser in left field bench third. Dustin Brisson, the first baseman, hitting cleanup. Pete Gavilan at third base, batting fifth. Andy Johnson, the designated hitter, bat sixth. Daryl Stevens in right field will hit seventh. Mike Fox is the shortstop, batting eighth. And the catcher, Brent Spooner, will bat ninth. For the Gators defensively, Jason Dill back, an everyday player defensively out there in left field coming off his injury. Greg Catalinotti in center, Peter Nystrom in right. Kurt Keene at third. Josh Canales filling in for the injured Mark Ellis at shortstop. Taylor Wood at second base. Brian Sheely at first base. And Todd Johannes, the catcher. And on the mound for the Gators is big Derek Devon, who makes tonight only his 2nd start of the year. 1 win, no losses, 4.97 ERA for Devon, who's pitched 25 and a third innings. He has walked 10 and struck out 19. An opponent's batting 262 against Derek Devon, who pitched briefly in the Friday night game at Mississippi State and got hit fairly hard to the 3 batters that he worked, and the Gators lost there on Friday night. Florida came back behind Sergio Rodriguez, outstanding pitching Saturday, to win the middle game of the series, and then got caught a little short in the pitching department on Sunday with the 2 injured pitchers, Bryce and Greslowski, unable to go, and the Gators lost that game on Sunday to lose 2 out of 3 in the series. There's a good look at Randy Harvey. He'll call the balls and strikes tonight as the home plate umpire. John Magnuson is the first base umpire, and Dennis McComb is our third base umpire tonight. We mentioned the conditions, 80 degrees, and right now, clear skies. The wind's kind of blowing in over the left field fence a little bit. We'll see how that plays as we go on throughout the night. Kind of humid here right now. This is the 26th meeting in the series. Florida has won 15 and lost 10. Two clubs have not played since the 1997 season. 19-11. Over the Gators. The Gators are 8-5 over UCF here in all games played in Gainesville. Well, there's a good look at tonight's leadoff hitter for UCF. Matt Meath, the second baseman, hitting 281 with a couple of home runs and 11 runs batted in. Settle back and enjoy Gator baseball tonight here on Sunshine Network. There are
did a great job about the middle of the season coming in, going in long relief, and has won more playing time this year. But his last outing, as you said, struggled over the weekend. And he'll be effective, Mick, if he keeps that slider down. That's where he got in trouble to Mississippi State last weekend, threw three hitters and had his slider hanging, and that's what made him ineffective against the Mississippi State Bulldogs.
1-1 the count. Well, Jay Bergman now in his 17th year at UCF, 655 wins there, and in his 23rd year, 873 wins overall, including this year. He's had only one losing season in his 23 years. Two balls and two strikes. UCF batting .318 as a team. That's the second best for the Golden Knights in their history. This ball bounced foul and fielded by Sheila. Their 1986 club finished with a .325 batting average. Tonight, if the Gators win, that man, Andy Lopez, will gain his 200th win as the head coach at Florida. Earlier this season, he picked up his 600th career victory. So these two head coaches with almost 1,500 lifetime victories between the two of them.
Jay Bergman had over 200 wins here at the University of Florida in the 70s and early 80s in his six-year tenure.
Andy Lopez should surpass Bergman's win total next year, which would be Andy's sixth season at Florida. 3-2 pitch is slapped out of play. And there's one of the killer bees, Nick, Mark Battier.
Yeah, they throw Battier, Bowser, and Brisson at you in the middle of, say, 2-3-4 in the lineup.
Full count. And Heath, like a good cleanup hitter, or a leadoff hitter. Pesky guy. And he draws a walk.
Yeah, walk-on player, overachiever, and he did a great job here. Leadoff man battled, fouled off a few pitches, and drew the walk. He'll run on you, 5-for-7 in stolen bases on the year. Jay Bergman teams like to run.
Well, here's Mark Battier hitting .353. No home runs, 17 runs batted in. Runner was going on the first pitch. He fouls it off.
Yeah, they're going to be aggressive tonight, and that's the way Jay plays it. If he's got the guys that can run, he'll turn them loose. And a guy like him, 5-for-7. Their best base dealer, Tim Booth, who's going to be hurt tonight. Talk about Ellis being out. One of their best players, Booth, is out. He has 41 stolen bases. He's on the bench with an injury.
Sheely holding him on.
Devon, tall pitcher, usually the taller pitchers are better guys to get jumps on. Lanky strides. Their windups are usually a little bit longer because of their size.
Devon's only decision this year, he beat Army back on March 17th. Pitched 5 innings in relief. His longest outing was the start he made against Jacksonville on March 30th when he went 5 2/3 innings. Was not involved in that decision. 1-1 pitch.
Pitches out of the strike zone, up and away, at a 1-3-1 delivery time, which isn't bad. You want to keep your delivery time around a 1-3-5 or lower. Give your catcher a fighting chance to throw out the base runner. Of course, on a breaking ball, it's usually going to be a little bit higher because of the slower pitch.
Battier played at North Florida Community College last year. And he played at Armstrong State, it was, in 1997. Two balls, two strikes, just the start of things tonight here at McKeithen Stadium between the Florida Gators and the Central Florida Golden Knights. The Knights as a team with 88 stolen bases and 112 attempts.
2-2 pitch, decent pitch to run on, especially if you're going to run 3-2, you might as well run 2-2.
Not going, and the pitch is skied. Canales going out, left fielder Dill coming in, and it will be Jason Dill. So Battier, a tough hitter, has been retired for the first out of the game.
Dill had a better shot at seeing that because he was running across, actually out of the way of the sun. And, you know, the center fielder coming in had a tougher play coming in on it.
Well, here's Matt Bowser, the left fielder, hitting .387 with 13 home runs and 60 runs batted in.
Freshman All-American, third team freshman All-American last year. Did an outstanding job this year. We said in the open, he just invited to the Olympic trials.
He put up some great numbers last year, and he's improved them all the way across the board this year.
As a high school senior, he was drafted in the 10th round by Toronto, was Bowser. He's a very good, consistent hitter, powered all fields.
And he's leading the club with 20 doubles. Now 2-0. Central Florida really in a tough stretch here right now. They've lost 7 of the last 9. They dropped a double dip at Mercer on Saturday, losing 11-3 in the opener and 11-6 in the nightcap. And now it's ball 3 and no strikes.
See, Jay Bergman turns him loose here. Bowser been hampered a little bit by a sore right hand. He's been hit a couple of times. So it's swollen right now. It's at 100%. A couple of their players have been dinged up as well, but they're in the lineup.
Right there for a called strike.
Well, do you start Meath at first base on the 3-1 count? I say go ahead and get it going.
Not going this time, and the pitch is fouled off first base way. So a full count now to Matt Bowser.
Now 3-2 count. See if Jay sends him. I say Jay sends him.
Meath at first base with one out. There goes the runner. The pitch low and away. Walked him. So a couple of first inning walks and runners at first and second for Central Florida. That'll bring up the dangerous cleanup hitter, Dustin Brisson.
First baseman, number 25, Dustin Brisson.
He's hitting .400, 16 home runs and 65 runs batted in. You don't want to make a mistake inside to this guy.
Greg Frady before the game, assistant coach at the University of Central Florida, talking about what has made Brisson so effective this year. Is Andy Lopez out to talk to Derek Devon here. Going over a little philosophy and what they're trying to do to the hitters. But what Greg Frady was talking about, Brisson, his ability to use the whole field, go opposite way, occasionally even drop a bunt down for a guy with 15 home runs, just utilizing every part of the field, being a complete hitter.
On the corner, nothing in two.
We saw a 308 hitter last year, average up 92 points.
Here's a look at the runners. Meath at second and Bowser at first. There's a ball driven pretty well. Catlinotti's first step was in. It hits the fence on one hop. Meath will score. They're waving home Bowser. They're going to make a play at third. There's the throw, and he's going to be out by a mile at third base. Good relay from Canales to Keene, but Brisson with a two-run double has given the Knights a 2-0 lead. And that's the way it goes. You give up two first-inning walks, and they both come back to score on you.
Absolutely. He goes down and gets it. That's a great piece of hitting right there. He goes down and gets it and drives it off the fence in center field, and he's a dead duck at third base. Keene with the easy tag.
That brings up Pete Gavilan, third baseman.
I guess what Brisson was trying to do is possibly take the extra base, had the relay gone to home, but smart play by Canales.
Hit hard to Wood, throws him out. Two runs on one hit, two walks proved costly. Golden Knights get two, and the Gators are coming up.
ASA Series, plus Pennzoil's World of Outlaws Sprint Car Racing and exclusive NHRA Drag Racing. We take you onto the track and into the pits. Nobody does it better. TNN, the leader in motorsports coverage.
Brought to you by Tallahassee's Best Rock, home of the John Boy and Billy Big Show, weekday mornings on Gulf 104.
Sam Satellite City, return desk.
We want to return this satellite dish we bought from you guys.
How come?
We can't get all the same channels we used to get with Comcast. We don't even get local channels anymore.
Really?
And you didn't tell me I need a separate receiver for each television.
I didn't.
With Comcast, additional outlets were easy.
We are not the cable company.
No kidding. That's why we need to return the dish.
Well, you'll just have to take a number and get in line.
If you're thinking about satellite TV, you might want to think twice. Comcast, everything you connect with.
With Nick Belmonte, Mick Hubert back at the ballpark. Central Florida leading it 2-0. Been a tough season for the Gators. They've had their share of injuries, and Andy Lopez knows it's just a matter of time as the Gators playing hurt.
We're banged up. We're banged up pretty good. And again, if we can get Bryce back and Grzelowski back and Ellis back and even McClendon. McClendon may be able to pitch a little bit this weekend. Then it sheds some light on some things for the weekend. It's a big weekend. Tonight's a big ball game as well. But as you mentioned, we're going to have to deal with some people that haven't been put in those roles tonight. And I'd hope that we could go in healthy this weekend and try to do the best we can.
Alabama coming to town for the SEC regular series finale. Andy Johnson has a swinging bunt base hit. Nothing that Keene could do but put it in his pocket, and a leadoff hit for Johnson.
And Alabama comes in with the second best record in the Southeastern Conference.
Darryl Stevens.
And they lead the league in hitting home runs, too. Well, that brings up Darryl Stevens now, the right fielder, hitting 247, has four home runs with 17 runs batted in. Two balls, no strikes.
Darryl Stevens and only 77 at-bats, four home runs. The guy with got some pop, but it's been inconsistent. Formerly drafted by the Atlanta Braves.
Yeah. look at Johnson at first base. Gator bullpen is going to get busy now. Sergio Rodriguez is going to get warming up.
It's going to be like looking into a mirror and get Sergio out there. Two pitchers right. Throwing the same way. Which may not be good for the hitter.
Two balls, one strike. Johnson not going as the pitch is fouled back.
Duvon, slow pace. Now his for his last two deliveries up around 1-4. Last one 1-6-6. So good pitches to go if you're a base runner. Although Johnson 1-for-1 in the stolen base department. As you look at Sergio, a Columbus High School product, Miami Columbus High.
Two balls, two strikes to Stevens. And that hit him. So not a good start for Duvall here in the second. Johnson at second base, Stevens at first, and nobody out.
I don't think Andy's going to wait much longer. This may be his last guy here. If he gets on, I think it's Sergio. As long as he's ready, he's going to come in.
Well, seven hitters. Two walks, a hit batter, two hits. Mike Fox, the shortstop, hitting 268.
Now it's up to Duvon right here. He's going to make or break his future, perhaps with this hitter. Showed bunt there, one sacrifice bunt on the year.
There are the runners. Johnson at second, Stevens at first.
Mike Fox, another guy who was a walk-on. Earned his way on the club, has improved himself a lot offensively, become more complete at the plate. He has a job to do here to get these runners moved along.
One ball, one strike. Knights with a second inning threat. They lead it 2-0. Gators have the wheel play on defensively there, but it's now 2-1.
Yeah, that's where the shortstop breaks for third. Keene and Sheely, the corner infielders, come crashing down. Second baseman Taylor Wood goes over to cover first base. Actually, he'll watch and see where the bunt's laid down. Sometimes you have a hitter, when that play's run, just swing the bat because there's a lot of holes created.
And these days, it can work a lot because I've seen such poor bunting in all the college baseball that they're better off just taking a hack at it.
Well, that's what happened right there. It looked like the wheel play was on again, and Jay Bergman, recognizing that, had his guy Fox go ahead and swing away.
Two balls, two strikes now to Mike Fox, sophomore from Coral Springs. Hit to the left side. Keene tried to tag the runner. Got him. Throws the first. Got him there. Oh, my. What a play by Keene. The Gators record their 56th double play. Five unassisted, three.
That's a mental mistake by the base runner, Johnson. I mean, if he just stops and lets him go ahead and make the play at first base, they get it's a hanging slider, but he gets them on the hands. Now, Johnson, all he has to do is just stop and let him make the play. But he got himself tagged, and Keene's smart, tagging a throw through. I mean, the play's right in front of him.
Well, now the catcher, Brent Spooner, a 3-0-1 hitter with five home runs and 34 runs batted in. So it's a much different looking inning right here now with a runner at second, but with two out. Bouncing ball to Canales from deep shortstop. Sheely couldn't pick it. And runners on the corners now.
Well, let's give credit where credit's due. The last two hitters, Devon, with a lot of pressure on him, has done a nice job coming back, enticing the five unassisted three. And here should be out number three. It's a routine 6-3 play. And Josh just doesn't get enough arm on it. Sheely can't get it on the back end. And the inning stays alive.
It's an error on Canales' throw. But yet it was one of the few that I can remember that Sheely hasn't picked. He has just picked everything over the last 4 to 6 weeks there at first base. Now here's Matt Meath. So I guess Sheely was due not to be able to sweep up everything over there. Gators have made 95 errors this year. 1.8 per game. There's the ball hit to right field. Nystrom coming in. We'll make the catch and the inning is over. So the Knights had their chance in the second and can't score a run. No runs on one hit. Two men left. Bottom of the second coming up. It's 2-0 UCF. Sports in Florida, click on sunshinenetwork.com, offering news, notes, and opinions by some of the state's best sports columnists and reporters. sunshinenetwork.com, your web source for Florida sports. Bottom half of the second here at McKeithen Stadium. Gators averaging 2,200 fans per game. Tonight to watch the first of four home games this week, the final four home games. The Gators close out their regular season on Sunday. The SEC tournament beginning next weekend at the Hoover Metropolitan Stadium in Hoover, Alabama, Birmingham suburb. Here in the second inning, it'll be Mike Floyd, followed by Taylor Wood, and then Todd Johannes. Floyd did not see any action this past weekend in Starkville. Brings the top hitting average on the team, though, at 380. Has 30 hits and 79 at bats. Floyd strained his left calf when he was sliding into second base in the South Carolina series back on April 23rd. That slowed him down a little bit.
Yeah, they've needed his bat. He's, as you said, the leading hitter average-wise, but injuries have slowed him up playing.
And getting a chance to start tonight with the left-hander, Bay Paul, on the mound for Central Florida.
Obviously, Floyd has done a pretty good job, but he's been in there.
Well, he's got some deceiving speed. For a guy as big as he is, he really runs well. He gets a lot of infield hits.
Floyd's a guy, too, that he'll look bad on two strikes, and then he'll just nail one.
Got a full count now.
Those guys are the most dangerous hitters because you think you're pitching into their weakness, and then they come back and get you.
3-2 pitch. He walked him. Ball wiggled off the hook in the first inning. Well, I shouldn't say that, really. I mean, he got in trouble, but then he helped himself out by striking out Bill Nystrom and Sheely, effectively striking out the side. And he puts the leadoff runner on base again here in the second inning. That's his first walk, and only the seventh walk of the year for this guy who's pitched 35 innings. Taylor Wood, who's been a pleasant surprise for Florida over the last 3 weeks. Hadn't played hardly at all until it got into the lineup in the Kentucky series. Now hitting at 340. A couple of home runs, 10 RBI.
All that moving around right there is basically telling the pitcher that he's not going. Because if he was going, he wouldn't be doing all that.
Two, they count. Tried to get him to reach after it.
One of the things you have to do on a guy like Babe Paul, that your hitting plan is to try to, he's going to try to go away from you, is try to use the right side of the field.
Well, he's now struck out four. He has four outs in the game, and he has four strikeouts in the game.
That's a changeup right there, and he just, you know, he's looking for a pitch away, and this thing is way out there.
Now Todd Johannes, the hitter.
What you want to do is look for a pitch, outer third, right over the plate, and it's going to break away on the corner and try to just go with it or up the middle. Best thing to do is not trying to pull a guy like him.
On the ground to Fox at short, he'll have to make the play to first. And now two out as Floyd takes second base on the play.
Shortstop, number six.
Now it's up to Josh Canales to drive in the run. The Gator shortstop. Canales hitting 227 with no home runs, one RBI. Had a career high two hits in Saturday's or in Sunday's game at Mississippi State, 2 for 3. Now Floyd had not thought about it, but then it's a good thing he didn't go that late.
There's a changeup right there going away. And you want to make sure with two outs, you're going to make it there. I don't think that was a real good time to go. He did the smart thing by staying.
Now ball two, no strikes to Canales.
80 to 90% of his pitches have been away. He doesn't like coming in too often. He may come in every now and then to keep you honest. Everything is, his changeup has run on it away from the right-handed hitter. And he tries to backdoor you with the curveball.
So he's trying to get you to swing at balls.
Yeah, exactly. And see, here's the thing. When you're throwing, you know, high 70s, low 80s, you know, it's pretty enticing, even though it's out of the strike zone.
What?
Then he might, you know, muscle up and zip one in, you know, 82, 83 is going to look like 92, 93. That's pitching.
3-1 the count to Canales. He held off, and wisely so, drawing a walk. So, for the second straight inning, the Gators with a couple of base runners, but with two out, is Floyd at second base. And Canales now at first.
When I played for Florida, we went up to Valdosta State. Jay Parkman probably get mad if you mentioned it. We went up there and faced a guy named Hodges McClendon, a lefty.
Keene lays down the bunt, making Gavilan try to make a tough play. Can't do it. Kurt Keene may have caught him napping a little bit, laying down that bunt. And the bases are now loaded.
Well, he definitely did in an RBI situation with two outs. He laying down a bunt is the last thing a third baseman is going to be looking for. And it's arguable whether that's going to be a good thing or not. But He did catch him napping, that's for sure. And a funny thing, that pitch should have never happened, and I'll tell you why. The shortstop, Mike Fox, was in back of the runner at second base. He was in back of Canella, actually in back of Mike Floyd on a pickoff play, and the pitcher should have stepped off.
Bases loaded for Greg Catalinotti. Base hit could tie the game. And fouls it back.
So going back to the story, so we went up to Valdosta State, and Hodges McClendon was throwing, this lefty was off-speeding us, throwing about 60 miles an hour, and we were all out on the front foot, popping things up left and right, and he ended up beating us, and it was just about time, and you were very comfortable 0 for 3 that day, you know. He didn't blow it by you, but next thing you know, you didn't get a hit. You had a lot of pop-ups that called third, you know, that kind of thing. And those guys are so frustrating.
You mean it happened even way back then?
Yeah.
I think that has happened since there have been left-handers in baseball.
And I'll tell you what, that was back in 76. That was before they had ear flaps on the helmets. Of course, that day we didn't even need helmets.
Oh, and two the count on Catalinotti.
And it was the week prior, University of Miami trots in with Stan Jakubowski throwing 92 miles an hour, and we knock him out of the ballgame.
Look at the runners. Canales, Floyd, Canales, and Keene. Catalinotti this year with the bases loaded, 2 for 7, has a grand slam home run and has 11 runs batted in with the bases loaded. And he's hoping to cash in right here. Oh, and he got called out on a fastball, busted on the fist. So, Paul has struck out 5 Gators who have left 5 men on base after 2 innings at Central Florida 2, and the Gators nothing. Nick Belmonte, Mick Hubert back at the ballpark. We're in the last half of the third inning. Still, and Central Florida leading it 2-0, and a new pitcher coming on for the Knights now. And right-hander Justin Pope coming in, perhaps just in time. 5-5 record, 6.19 ERA. And sees. Been largely a starting pitcher. His 20th appearance and 14 have been starts. He's pitched 72 and two-thirds innings, allowed 101 hits. Walked 22, struck out 61. Opponents batting 330 against him. He's given up 8 home runs on the year.
He puts it in play. No question about that, but he does throw a strike.
So Paul went tonight 2 1/3 innings, allowed 3 hits, and as of yet, no runs. He walked 3 and struck out 5 and made a total of 59 pitches in the game.
And in the ponderous 2 1/3 innings that Babe Paul threw, the Gators really did not get that many good hacks at him. 3 hits, 1 a bunt.
So both starting pitchers are out of the game. Paul left with a count of 2-0, so Pope and Harrit's 2 ball, no strike count to Floyd.
And this is more like the type of pitcher that the Gators have had success with. And you're just more inclined to have seen a guy like this.
Now one more like that would load them up.
As a hitter, you just feel a lot more comfortable facing a more conventional type pitcher.
Gill at third base, Nystrom at first, and the fake throw to third. Well, now Sergio Rodriguez, the Gator pitcher who is in the game, gets tired of sitting in the dugout. He's going to get up and throw a little soft toss there on the warning track and foul ground to keep loose. Chopper to short, tough hop, Fox was undecided as to how to play it. And Floyd with the good speed made him pay.
Gators get a run. Nick, it looked like Fox's first step was in and then back.
Yeah, he got caught in between right there, and the ball ended up handcuffing him. And you said Floyd going hard the whole way, and you love seeing that. And it looked like he kind of nonchalanted it as if, well, I know I got at least one, but he sure didn't.
So it's a 2-1 game now. And runners at first and second for the Gators with one away for Taylor Wood. Hits it sharply to Fox on the bag for one and the double play. Six unassisted, three takes the Gators down in the third. They score one run on one hit. There was one error, one man left. After three, it's 2-1.
Orlando Miracle.
Hey, Orlando, join in. The WNBA is coming to Central Florida as the Orlando Miracle debut this summer. And a Miracle game is something the whole family can enjoy, with lower bowl tickets starting at just $8.
The fans have got to be excited and enjoy the first year, because there'll never be another first.
So be a part of the excitement as the Miracle begin their inaugural season. For tickets, call 407-916-WNBA.
Log on to sunshinenetwork.com for inside information from the men on the scene. From the field to the locker room and everywhere in between, Paul Kennedy covers it all. sunshinenetwork.com, your web source for Florida sports.
Can't miss Baseball Thursday. East meets West in an AL showdown. Bo Vaughn powers the Hungry Halos against Derek Jeter and the world champion Yanks. Can't miss Baseball Thursday on Sunshine.
Stephen C. O'Connell Center, where it should be jumping next year for Gator basketball.
Is that it there?
That's a shot from the satellite, looking down on Earth from way up there. I think 22,300 miles. There's a shot from our Earth level camera. Several. Must be a couple thousand earthlings here tonight. Andy Johnson fouls the first pitch out of play down the right side. Northeast Louisiana leading LSU tonight 2-1 in the third inning. LSU's playing great SEC baseball on the weekends. They're really moving along. They're in last place for a while.
Yeah, 10-10 at one time.
Yep. In fourth now, making a charge.
At the right time.
Nick, did you see where Skip Burton was hospitalized in a regular heartbeat? Wish him the best.
It absolutely.
Was, on the flight home Sunday from Athens to Baton Rouge. Felt a little nauseous and hope he's resting comfortably. Johnson strikes out. And that'll bring up Darryl Stevens as we get another look at it. Sergio's tough.
Got on the chase, and you can do that with your head. A little something in the dirt. Down fishing.
Pitch heading for Central Florida. Number 8, Jeremy Frost.
You know, Darryl Stevens was due up, but they're going to take him down now. As you look at Jeremy Frost, who is going to pinch hit. Frost hitting 258, 5 home runs, 27 RBIs.
He came on the scene in a quick way. His first hit in collegiate baseball, of course, this year being a freshman, was a grand slam, and his second hit was a solo homer.
What'd he do that third time?
Jeez. You're a tough grader, Mick.
One ball, one strike. He should be good early in the year with a name like Frost.
Yeah.
2-2.
Little changeup right there on the corner.
Another strikeout for Rodriguez. He struck out three of the five batters he's faced.
He goes the pitch before. Now watch his hands come in, Frost. He tries to make an adjustment, ties him up. He was looking away, then he saw a pitch in and had to adjust to it, but just couldn't do it. He had him going with the changeup away, then came in with the curveball.
Now Mike Fox, the batter. He's the shortstop. Two to one game here at McKeithen Stadium tonight as Central Florida leads it here on the top of the fourth inning. They got two runs in the first on a double by Brisson, and the Gators got one run in the bottom of the third.
Well, Andy's getting exactly what he wants out of Sergio. He may go, like I said, one time around the order. He's had him baffled since he's come in.
The ground, right side, diving try by Wood, but out in the right field for a two-out single for Fox.
Just hitting the right spot. Sergio did a nice job enticing the ground ball, but just under Taylor Wood's glove.
So hit number five for the Knights. Here's catcher Brent Spooner.
It's interesting here what Jay Bergman wants to do, because Frost is a guy that runs pretty well. 6-for-6 in stolen bases, but he's got his number 9 hitter up.
And it's tough to get a good lead, too, off Rodriguez.
Yeah, he'll make you work over there. But Spooner, not your typical number 9 hitter, 300 hitter. 5 home runs.
Played at Tallahassee Community College last year.
That's Mike McLeod. He does a great job up there. Coach at TCC. Actually, Mike McLeod and Jay Bergman go back. Mike McLeod played on a summer league team that Jay Bergman had, and I played on that one. They played in the what they call the NBC tournament in Wichita, Kansas, the premier tournament in summer baseball, and Mike McLeod was a pitcher on that team. Outstanding career. Building a new stadium out there next year. Stadium after Jay Bergman. So he'll be playing in his own stadium, Jay Bergman Stadium. That's quite an honor. Well deserved, as he has done everything and put that program on the map.
2-1 pitch. Fly ball into center field. Catman waiting. And then he couldn't find it. And now, with a throw coming home, Spooner takes second base. Boy, I was about to say it was a can of corn, but he wasn't close enough to the shelf.
And you can see he's just saying right there, actually, that probably, well, it shouldn't have mattered with two out. The runner should have been not even looking at Catalanotti.
Number 17.
And he just lost it, and looks like we're still a little bit in the twilight. He just lost it. The Gators are very lucky. You can see right there is the sun setting probably about half an hour, 45 minutes ago, but lights haven't taken effect 100%.
Now here's Matt Meath. Now the Knights have a chance to score a couple of runs with two outs.
And like I said, the Gators lucky that a run did not score on that play. And that ball had a lot of hang time, and very easily, you know, if you're on your horse, you're going to make a play of it.
Right in here for a strike.
And I think Jay Bergman did the right thing, because I saw where the runner was when the throw was coming in, and he was just getting in the third. I think if he sends him, he's out.
Strikeout here. Struck out the first two hitters. Then Fox had the base hit to right, and then Spooner with the ball just a moment ago out to center field. And hanging tough.
Yeah, and Spooner had to be scored a base hit, a single, and then Calinotti just took it and winged it in the home, and Spooner took second base on the throw. He was just going for everything was Calinotti on the throw. And it was a good throw, and actually help keep the runner at third base.
Now the 1-2 pitch. He held off. But
I got to think, in a situation like that, most runners are going to have a legitimate chance to score with two outs.
Him inside, now a full count. Fox at third and Spooner at second. Ball three, strike two to Matt Meath. Bouncing ball, Taylor Wood at second. Throws to Sheely at first, retire the side. The Knights are gone in the fourth inning. No runs on two hits. They strand two runners, but move to the last of the fourth inning. The Knights continue to lead 2-1.
Is your car still running bad? Well, don't get mad. Get Motor Up, the no oil change engine treatment for a smoother, quieter, and cooler running car. Over 3 million people have already added Motor Up to their automobiles, and now you can too with our special 30-day free trial offer. Just call the number on your screen and tell the operator that you want to try Motor Up before you buy it. This is a unique opportunity for anyone who's never tried Motor Up to try it now, risk-free. It's so easy. Just add one bottle to your car's engine, and you'll see, feel, and hear a difference almost immediately.
Without a doubt, it's definitely running cooler.
And it's running quieter.
It doesn't shake at all. Look at it.
It's definitely running smoother.
Use Motor Up, and you'll get the same amazing results. And because you don't have to change your oil to add Motor Up, you'll save time and money. Before you spend more on costly repairs, call this number now. Put Motor Up to the test and see for yourself. This incredible 30-day free trial offer won't last long. So call now.
With Nick Belmonte, I'm McHubert, back at McKeithen Stadium. Bottom half of the fourth, Central Florida leading it 2-1. Let's take a look at that play out in center field, Nick. Here's Fox running the bases.
Yeah, it looks like Fox is going half speed right there, and now he sees it land. He starts picking it up. And had he taken off hard on the two-out pitch that was hit, then I think he scores fairly easy. So,
yeah, there's a happy Gator fan.
For Central Florida,
a souvenir ball.
Jeremy Frost remains in the game at the new Golden Knight.
Well, Jeremy Frost, who pinch hit for Darryl Stevens, is going to take Stevens' place in the field as well. Jeremy Frost is the new right fielder now for Central Florida here as we go to the last of the fourth inning. Todd Johannes will lead it off for the Gators. Here's Frost in right.
Well, right on cue at the tip of the cap, huh?
Mm. Well, you know, they got these new transmitters now and receivers. But, you know, all the guys have them. And, Nick, they know every time you say something bad about them, they know.
Good. Then maybe they'll do something, right?
You know, that's off in the space program, you know, and then they put it in the football helmets, and now it's in the
trickle-down
caps as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we're going to get one of those so we can hear what we're saying.
What fun would that be?
One ball, two strikes to Johannes. He grounded out to the shortstop, Mike Fox, back in the second inning.
Talk about a situation the Gators would love to get this leadoff guy on.
Well, if he gets on, it'd be a perfect 4-for-4 in terms of a leadoff man reaching base to start every inning. And last inning, the Gator leadoff runner, Dill, scored the Gators' first run. And here's ball to deep short. That's going to be an infield base hit for Johannes. Gators' fourth hit of the game.
And the Gators have a situation here now with Canales, who can do a lot of things. You can lay a bunt down as we're going to look at the swing of Johannes. Just hits it in the right spot, ground ball, and Fox does the wise thing and just doesn't make a throw. And only bad things happen when you have to rush something on an obvious infield hit.
Bunt situation for Canales. It's a good one, too. And safe at first, and here goes Johannes for third. Steve Kling will throw up the stop sign and hold him there. And the Gators have him on the corner, but nobody out.
The almighty bunt comes through again. If you've got a guy that can lay a bunt down, it wreaks havoc with the defense, because in college baseball today, there's so little bunting going on. When somebody knows how to do one, you know, good things happen for you when you're the offense.
Boy, it was just textbook there, Nick. Where he shortened the bat.
And it's where he bunted the ball. It's not the element of surprise. He showed it fairly early, but it's the placement. And that's why you get yourself set nicely like Josh did. I don't see how they score that. Well, obviously, there's going to be an error for the runner to go to second, but I wonder if they give him a hit or not.
They did. Bunt single, and Johannes took third on the error. And there's a base hit to left field for Keane. His third hit of the game. An RBI ties the game at 2-2. So Kurt Keane with his 34th run batted in.
And this is the type of pitcher the Gators are more comfortable with. Like I said, a more conventional type hitter. And you know, it was a pretty good pitch. It was just another ground ball hitting the right spot. The guy that gets it going, Johannes, scoring the tying run right there.
Kurt Keane now has three consecutive three-hit games. Greg Catalinotti now, for the first time, can turn around and be a left-hand hitter.
And with nobody out, you've got your power guy up. So if you're thinking along the lines of bunt, you might want to rethink that, because the Catman could turn this into a three-run homer in a hurry.
The count. Catalinotti has driven in a run in 11 of the last 12 games and leads the ball club with 51 runs batted in. Last year he had 61 RBI.
And this is the guy you want up there with runners at first and second, two men aboard, a guy who can knock in 2 to 3 with one swing. Brent Cozart's going to go out there now. Talk to Justin Pope.
Well, no action in the UCF bullpen. Central Florida got two runs in the first inning, but Gators have tied them up. Florida getting a run in the third, and now this one here in the fourth inning. Gators have a great chance. They've had scoring opportunities all night. They left two on base in the first inning. Left the bases loaded in the second. Left the man on again in the third. And have two runners aboard here, still with nobody out, as you see the runners. Keane and Canales. 2-1 pitch. Good fastball.
off side.
Well, he challenged him there, 2-2, came right in. Greg would like to have that pitch back again. See if he tries to bounce him one, see if he gets Catalanotti to chase.
Well, the hits are now even at 6-6, and the game tied at 2-2. Central Florida, though, has made three errors tonight. This pitch hit high in the sky to right field. Frost back, it is gone! Home run for Catalanotti. Three-run blast. And the Gators have taken a 5-2 lead. Run batted in. RBIs 52, 53, and 54.
And that's why you don't have the Catman bunt, because he's very capable of doing what he just did. And here's the breaking ball right here, down and in. It just kind of stays out there for him. And, you know, we're watching the Catman the last 2 years. You know, he likes it in that spot.
Still nobody out. Four consecutive hits for Florida. And now here's Jason Dill.
And that's why we said you might want to bounce him a curveball, because you get him to chase something in the dirt, but he just left too much of that in the air.
This pitch will be fouled off to the left and will be out of play.
So many times you've seen the left-handed hitters like that pitch down and in. The Cat's no difference.
By the way, that was the ninth home run allowed by Pope now. Second on the club. 0-2 the count to Dill. That's the first out of the inning. Second time tonight that Dill has fanned. It's the first strikeout for Justin Pope. That brings up Pete Nystrom. And down in the bullpen there for the Central Florida, Jason Arnold. He's been the workhorse in terms of appearances. He's made 21 appearances this year.
He's been the closer.
Ball bounced foul on the first base side.
But Jay Bergman knows how important this game is, playing against an SEC opponent. Team like Florida, you know, if you're on the bubble for a regional bid, he knows a win here tonight will go a long way.
Tried to stay back on the breaking ball, but a little hump back. Two out.
There's Jay there, and Greg Frady does a great job, one of his assistants, and trying to figure out now what they're going to do there. They're down three. And Sergio Rodriguez has had his offense off balance, where they came out swinging.
You know, Rodriguez is getting out of the dugout again, going to loosen up on the sideline, and maybe an indication how important it is to Andy Lopez also. We'll pick up more on that as we go to the next inning, as the Gators are out. But the first four Gators got hits, and they all scored. Four runs, four hits. We move to the fifth inning. It's now the Gators 5 and Central Florida 2.
You don't get in this kind of shape running on a treadmill. You do it with strength exercise, and I do it with a Bowflex. You know, if you're not working out with strength training right now, you need to. Because if you want to lose weight, you got to add the muscle, and that's why you need a Bowflex machine. It's like nothing else you've ever tried before. We've got over 60 exercises you can do on a Bowflex. You're never going to get bored. You can do a full workout in 20 minutes on a Bowflex machine. You're not going to believe how effective Bowflex is the first time you get on it. Bowflex may look a little different, but that's because we designed it to function correctly. Bowflex uses power rod resistance. Bowflex power rods are so effective that Bowflex guarantees results in 6 weeks or your money back. Try going to the gym and getting a guarantee on results. You won't find it. If you call and get our free videotape, you're going to see an effective workout and see how easy and quick and fun working out with Bowflex is.
50 years experience, one health plan. That's HIP Health Plan of Florida. We go to the top of the fifth inning now here at McKeithen Stadium. And the Gators in front for the first time in the game. They have 5 runs, 7 hits, and 1 error. And Central Florida with 2 runs on 6 hits, 3 errors. Mark Battier leads off the fifth inning. Showing bunt, falling right through the breaking ball. You know, Nick, a lot of times when Rodriguez or any of the starters pitch in midweek, they're around the 30-pitch mark, kind of like simulating a bullpen. Well, Rodriguez has made 35 pitches, and yet he goes out to begin this inning. But they also get somebody busy in the bullpen just in case.
Well, Andy might see how it goes here. He hasn't gone all the way through the lineup. If he faces Bowser, then he'll go 9 hitters. So maybe he'll see if he goes through Bowser and Brisson, who struck out, before he makes a move.
One and two, the count on Battier. Battier 1 for 2 tonight. Has one on the ground to Sheely. Sheely now going to flip it and made a bad decision there. I don't know. Rodriguez a little tardy getting there, but Sheely just got to come on and make that play.
Yeah, and Ryan's got to realize that he didn't get off the mound real quick. You never make a throw unless you absolutely have to. And I'll tell you what, you can see that he was nowhere near the base. The only way that play could have been made is Sheely taking it himself.
Stuart McFarland loosening up. I don't think Sheely had to move very far for the ball, which probably gave Rodriguez a...
That's not an excuse, though.
Well, I know.
Yeah,
but I'm sure he was reading and saying, well, it hit right in front of him. And hence, just a split-second delay, not there in time.
Yeah, what Sheely has to do at that point is wave off Sergio and take it himself. And you never want to make that throw. If you think it's going to be close, you're better off taking it yourself. If you think you can get there just about the same time as the pitcher, then wave him off, because the last thing you want to do is flip the ball in the air. That's one extra thing that can go wrong. You always talk about the 3 things that go wrong with a forward pass. It's the same thing there. You know, you put it in the air, bad things can happen. You take it yourself, 9 times out of 10, you're going to, unless you stumble over and fall down, you're going to make the play yourself. And every now and then you'll see a first baseman go ahead and make a flip when he could take it himself, just, I don't know, because the pitcher's there and it looks nice, but it's not a wise thing to do.
2 balls, 1 strike as Rodriguez makes the throw to first.
Some first basemen are way better than others on making flips. Unless you're Mark Grace, who has that play down. It's a tough play.
Nice curveball.
Boy, I tell you, that's a tough pitch. It looks like it's behind his back, Mac. Look at this. Mm. That's going to hit me. Oh, no, it isn't.
That's nasty. Right there, Sheely says, I got a room service double play.
No throw needed.
Gators have turned a pair of double plays today. And they've not been of the real conventional variety.
I'll tell you, Bowser does a great job right there keeping his shoulder in, just lines it right at Sheely. Just a bad break.
Sure. Because, Nick, if there's nobody on first base, he's got a hit here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this thing's curving down the line for sure, Mick.
Or if there's a guy on second, yeah.
If it's any place but a runner at first.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that thing's down the line.
It's been the Sheely inning. There's how you do it. Inning over. One hit but no runs, a double play. The Gators have turned a SEC best 57 double plays on the year. And the Gators with the halfway point lead tonight. It's 5-2.
Buckle up. I forgot the tickets.
Access One, remote keyless entry by Titan. Get a lock on the future.
Come home to Sunshine Network for complete coverage of Gator baseball. When Bama's Tide rolls in to challenge the Gators, the SEC heats up. So Gator bats must be burning. Alabama battles Florida Friday night at 7 on Sunshine. The number one seed in the East, and it's payback time for Miami. Round one is underway, and the Heat are hoping for a Knicks knockout. Game three of the playoffs. Coverage begins Wednesday at 7:30 on Sunshine.
Bottom half of the fifth inning now. Gators leading it 5-2. It'll be Mike Floyd, Taylor Wood, Todd Johannes leading it off. Gators getting four runs last inning when the first four Gator hitters got on base. Four straight hits, and they all four scored. So here's Floyd, who has been on base twice tonight. He drew a walk in the second, was safe on an error in the third.
Unlike Babe Paul, now the Gator hitters can keep their shoulders in and pull the ball or hit them up the middle. Whereas if they were trying to do that against Babe Paul, chances are they're going to just be off the front foot and off balance. They can get more in their mindset of what they see almost on an everyday basis against Pope. See what that soft toss and lefty will do. You see what Rodriguez has done to Central Florida. I mean, it's a disruption of your timing. See, John Tudor did so well many years.
Tommy John also.
Tommy John, same thing. Just the second Tommy John after the TJ surgery. He used to throw hard with coming up with the White Sox. And yeah, Tommy John was so great keeping you off balance.
I have a Tommy John 1964 rookie card.
Well, there's a case of looking for the local and getting the express. That's the fastball, and he's looking breaking ball the whole way, and he swung after it was by him. Tommy John rookie card.
Yeah.
Oh. That was quite the club.
Yeah, back in those days, they had... They split the card in half. The guy on the top and the guy on the bottom. I have no idea who was on the other half of the card.
Probably J.C. Martin.
I remember him. Left-hand hitting catcher.
Yeah.
He was good at catching the knuckleball. The White Sox had...
That is correct.
Eddie Fisher, Wilbur Wood.
Yeah.
And Martin was the knuckleball catcher.
Camilo Carrion was another catcher they had.
Mm-hmm.
His son Mark had a big league career. Play for the Mets.
Isn't that something that we would talk about a guy who was a knuckleball catcher, you know? I don't know of any current players more renowned for being a knuckleball catcher. Not that many knuckleballers around anymore. I think the split-fingered fastball had a lot to do with kind of a decline in knuckleball.
Yeah, and you know, they were saying a lot of knuckleballers, I guess, once Negro retired, the running game was becoming a very popular thing, and guys were getting great jumps on the knuckleball.
I There was a game a couple of weeks ago in the big leagues that matched a couple of knuckleballers in Wakefield and Candiani.
Yeah, and I played minor league ball with Tom Candiani before he hurt his arm. He was a hard-throwing, a fastball slider guy. And the knuckleball saved his career. You know, he's in his 40s now and he's still out there dealing. Because if you have that pitch down, it's eternally going to be a tough pitch to hit. It will always be a tough pitch to hit. It's just strange pitch.
Look at this. Johannes, sharp single to right field. He's got a two-hit ball game. Gators have now out-hit him 8-7. So a two-out single to right.
Number six, Josh.
Brings up Josh Canales, who laid down a bunt single in the fourth inning. He also walked in the second, so he's had two plate appearances, reaching base twice. Hit it sharply, but on one hop, Gavilan will make the play to meet. Inning over. One hit, but no runs, and one man left. We've completed five innings at McKeithen Stadium. Our score remains Florida 5 and Central Florida 2.
Are you living in the dark ages using dangerous sharp knives? Well, step into the future with the amazing new Rotato, the easiest and safest way to peel fruits and vegetables. Just load the Rotato, adjust the spring-loaded robotic arm, and watch the razor-sharp Kai blade conform to any fruit or vegetable. Spend less time preparing meals and more time enjoying them. It peels potatoes, tomatoes, even kiwis. You'll do apples for applesauce, lemons for lemon zest, exotic fruits like mangoes for healthy fruit salads, and nothing goes to waste. Order now, and you'll also receive this julienne slicer, a $10 value at no extra charge. But if you pick up the phone in the next 10 minutes as a special one-time bonus, the exclusive Tap and Chop is yours free. It makes short work of all your chopping needs. Tap and Chop does onions, herbs, nuts, even ice. You'll receive the Rotato, all the accessories, the julienne maker, and the Tap and Chop, all for just $29.99. Order now.
To order Rotato for only $29.99 plus shipping, call 1-800-738-8448. That's 1-800-738-8448, or send check or money order to the address on your screen.
Well, the Gators wrap up the 1999 home schedule this weekend against Alabama. Friday at 7, it's Fan Appreciation Night. Fans can register to win a 2000 Gator Baseball season pass, a Gator Baseball cap, and a Gator Baseball jersey. Saturday game time is 3 o'clock. And the Sunday finale will start at 1:30. For tickets to this big series with the Crimson Tide, call 1-800-34-GATOR. Now here's the SEC standings, where Arkansas has the best record in the league, and Alabama, which comes in here this weekend, second. We talked about the fast-charging LSU team, and the Gators are trying to squeeze in there in that eighth spot, or the Gators still could be the Eastern Division champions. You know, the way the tournament is set up, the two division winners will be the top two seeds in Birmingham. Pete Gavilan, first ball swinging, sends Catalanotti back, and he can't hang on to it. He had a juggling catch opportunity, but ran out of room in the fence and could not hold on to the ball.
That's frustrating, too, because Cat had it. He's going back. He's got it measured. And it pops off the heel of his glove, and then when he tries to corral it after it popped out, that's when he hits the fence, and the ball at that point bounced off his body and went to the ground.
And they've charged him with an error.
Oh, man.
Andy Johnson swings, hits one down the right side, just foul.
The only reason why you know you don't give him an error, and I'll tell you why, because he has a chance to still come up with the catch. The ball pops up and he's going to get it back in his glove from what I saw in that replay, and then the fence comes into play, and you can't fault him for having the fence there, you know, because he's not done with the play yet. A tough air, especially if a ball hit over your head that you have to outstretch for, and then you collide into the wall.
time and on defense.
Defense. Exactly. Took me a while. Thank you.
Rodriguez has made 50 pitches since he came on with nobody out in the second, so he's working in his fourth inning of relief. Bullpen at the moment, not busy. At Mississippi State on Saturday, the game Rodriguez won, he went 6 2/3 innings, made 105 pitches. And just walked in. So now they're going to bring the tying run to the plate. Runners at first and second. Well, if you're just joining us, I'm Mick Hubert, along with Nick Belmonte. Happy that you're with us here on Sunshine Network tonight from McKeithen Stadium here at Gainesville. The Gators are leading it 5-2, having scored four runs in the fourth inning to take the lead. But the Knights are threatening here as Jeremy Frost comes up with runners at first and second and nobody out. Frost showing the bunt, pushes it up the first base side. Good bunt. Rodriguez has to make an acrobatic scoop. Great sacrifice by Frost.
Great play all around. Now, here's what I love about what Frost did. He showed bunt right away. The term is sacrifice. So he's saying, I'm giving myself up, and I'll tell you what, I'm going to get in good bunting position while I'm doing it. He said, there's no surprises here. You can see what he does. Great job getting it down. The angle was perfect. Sergio had a tough time and had to make a great play. Another inch and bases are loaded, nobody out. But I'll tell you, Frost did a great job.
Now Mike Fox, the hitter, singled the last time up. I think the other thing I liked about Nick and that low angle we showed was the bat was out in front, up in front of the plate.
Yeah, it's
hard to bunt when you're behind the point of the plate, aren't you?
Exactly. You're bunting the ball in the fair territory,
right?
Because a lot of times if you have it back over home plate, it'll hit the plate and scoot foul, even though you have had a good bunt going.
Well, they're going to concede a run, I guess. Yep. Wood throws to first. RBI ground out for Fox's. Gavilan has scored. And it's now 5-3 with Andy Johnson moving over to third base. Two away here in the UCF sixth inning.
I have a feeling that Coach Ricky Gage has a lot to do with their bunters because he set a career record for sacrifice bunts at UCF. I'm sure he'll take advantage of his expertise.
Brent Spooner, the catcher. And there's the man who has been the Friday night starter the last few weeks for Florida, Jeff Cardozo, warming up down there.
Midweek game, nothing. Both these coaches want this one.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a situation where, Nick, I think that if you're Andy Lopez and say you're at this point in the game and you're down 8-3, you might not pitch this way necessarily.
Oh,
but
no.
When you're up 5-3 in the sixth, you got one.
Hey,
you're closing in on one.
Exactly. And he told his team, he said, look, we got four games here. And, you know, let's play hard and see what happens. And he is the coach, is showing him he's going to go with his best guys.
You know, especially with the absence of Reslovsky and Bryce, although Reslovsky
right.
could possibly throw.
And Ellis being hurt tonight mm-hmm. as well.
When you take a look at Reslovsky and Bryce, I mean, there are 14 wins between them with an ERA combined, which would be somewhere about 2.5. You can just see right there the effectiveness of these two guys. They have the most number of wins on the club.
Yeah, once McClendon went down, these guys had to step in and get the job done.
Yes. And they answered it, too.
Yeah, you can see 7-3 and 9-5. And they had to log the extra innings.
Mm-hmm. That put a strain on everybody. Just foul and just past Johnson.
Let's see if Sergio goes a little changeup action here, running away from Spooner to see if he gets him to chase.
Johnson at third with two out. The Knights with a run in here in the sixth inning, but the Gators still leading 5-3. Fly ball to center. Been somewhat of an adventure tonight out there, but Cantwell, he said, not this time. He's there to make the catch. In the inning, Central Florida gets one run, no hits, an error, man left. Gators lead 5-3.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dan Dierdorf. Where would you go for a home equity loan? Let's ask.
Oh, banks have the best rates.
But banks only lend money when you don't need it.
Advana National Bank is different. They lend money to people when they need it.
Right. With my credit?
They made their first loans 45 years ago to teachers who had trouble borrowing. They helped out when others wouldn't.
This is a bank, right?
With customers who get the flexibility only a national bank can offer, right over the phone.
You gotta move all your accounts there.
Nope, just call Advana. One of their loan specialists will show you how to use the equity in your home to pay off all of your bills. Get one low monthly payment and save hundreds of dollars a month, plus a tax deduction.
You'll wait for some board to approve.
You'll get fast approval over the phone. And your money in about 10 days. You don't need to have money in the bank to get money from a bank. To get the loan you want, call Advanta at 1-800-398-6880. You'll see, they're different. Hey, they don't keep banker's hours either.
In the eighth inning. It's time now.
Sheraton Gainesville, the official hotel of Florida Gator Baseball and Sunshine Network.
One lucky fan will be chosen to win a new Dodge truck.
Bottom of the sixth inning now. A lovely night here in North Central Florida. Gators 5 runs, 8 hits, 2 errors. And Central Florida 3 runs on 7 hits. They've committed 3 errors. It'll be the top of the Gator batting order, as Kurt Keene has a perfect night going so far. 3 singles, 3 for 3 for Keene. He began the night hitting .296. Now hitting at .306. So 3 hits, 10 points on the batting average. It'll be Keene, Catalanotti, and Dill, the top of the Gator batting order in the sixth inning, against right-hander Justin Pope. The Gators this year, when leading after 6 innings, are 25-1. And Keene has a 4-hit game. Around first, on his way to second. And a double for Keene. His 12th of the year, the Gators have now hit 104 doubles this season. And Keene with a 4-hit game. And that is his second 4-hit game this season.
He is right on this thing. Perfect timing on that ball. Right down the line, shoulders in, head down. What a night.
Keene's career high is 5 hits. He did that in a Tennessee Volunteer uniform. Got it against Morehead State on March the 4th, 1997. So this equals his Gator career high, having also had a 4-hit game against South Carolina. Catalanotti rips one into the gap right center field. Keene being waved home will score easily. Catman heading for second. Here's the throw. He's safe at second base. Back-to-back doubles. And the Gators lead 6-3.
Nice hustling play by Catalanotti, following up a bullet, hitting the gap. Never stopped, saw the play in front of him, and just went for it.
put the pressure on the outfielder, Frost. Same thing, head down, nice. The Gator hitter is really hitting the ball well right now. Now, he sees that Frost has to go a ways and picks it up fairly deep. And as Keene scores easily, Catalanotti is going hard for second base, going hard right off the bat.
Now, the Catman now with four runs batted in tonight's game, and his double has effectively KO'd Justin Pope. As Jay Bergman will go into the UCF bullpen now. As the Knights are going to get a new pitcher coming into the game, and Jason Arnold coming in as Catman's 11th double has given the Gators a 6-3 lead. We'll return to McKeithen Stadium and tell you about the new Central Florida pitcher in just a moment.
It's nighttime on Sunshine. The UCF Golden Knights are ready for action. No matter the season, no matter the sport, it's nighttime on Sunshine. It's a golden year for UCF athletics, and Sunshine Network is there for every tackle, hammer dunk, touchdown, and set to slam combination. From Heisman hoopla to hoops flooring and everything in between, this is your home for the Golden Knights. The Golden Knights play your game all year long on Sunshine Network.
Well, the Gators now have 10 hits in tonight's game, and they've opened a 6-3 lead. Catalanotti at second base with nobody out as the new pitcher continues his warm-up tosses for Central Florida. Right-hander Jason Arnold coming in. 6 wins, 4 losses, Nick, for this guy. 308 ERA.
Yeah, look at the numbers. 49 and two-third innings pitched. 45 hits, 67 strikeouts, 27 walks. And a 6'3", 190 body throws the ball up to 94 at the clock, 94 miles an hour. Along with the kind of a slider curve or a swerve, if you will, and a straight chain. So we're going to see gas from this guy.
Now Arnold, with 19 saves, he's just two shy of the school record. He's outstanding out of the bullpen for Jay Bergman.
A nice shot of John Magnuson there. One of the top umps in the country in college baseball.
John has worked the College World Series before in Omaha. Jason Dill tonight, 1-for-3 with a pair of strikeouts. Arnold from Melbourne.
So you know the umpires are doing a great job. They pretty much go unnoticed. And that's the motto of an ump. If we go unnoticed, we're doing a great job.
2 balls and 1 strike.
There's John.
Ground shortstop. It'll keep Catalanotti. Now he's going to try and make a delayed run throw, and they throw it away. Catalanotti tried to come on a delayed play. If Grisson makes a good throw, they're going to get him. But the fourth error of the night for Central Florida has allowed the Gators to score. It's now 7-3.
Dell gets jammed, pulls the hands in, really doesn't do much with it. He's disgusted as he leaves the box. And you see Cat waiting for the throw, trying to time it perfectly, and he did. Well, put it this way, a good throw, and it's probably not a smart play.
The error charge to Grissom, that's her fourth error. So now two out. That'll bring up first baseman Ryan Sheely.
The first baseman, number 43, Ryan Sheely.
Sheely tonight is 0 for 3. Strikeout, fly out, ground out. Gators getting two runs here in the bottom of the sixth. And now a 7-3 Florida lead. On the breaking ball, and the inning is over, but the Gators have scored two more runs. They get back-to-back doubles from Keene and Cat, and after six, it's the Gators 7 and Central Florida 3.
Universities have always been about expanding horizons, enriching the student's experience. At UCF, a now university, we've raised the stakes. In one of the most dynamic areas of the world, UCF taps the region's unrivaled resources through partnerships with industry and government. The University of Central Florida, a now university, Florida's educational attraction.
Can't miss Baseball Thursday. East meets West in an AL showdown. Bo Vaughn powers the Hungry Halos against Derek Jeter and the world champion Yanks. Can't miss Baseball Thursday on Sunshine.
Attention golf fans.
The PGA Tour's on Fox Sports Net. Live. Thursday to Friday coverage of the big boys on the big tour, where every round counts. The GTE Byron Nelson Classic. Thursday and Friday at 4 on Sunshine.
With Nick Belmonte, Mick Hubert back at the ballpark. Gators leading 7-3. Jay Bergman, great college baseball coach. He's taking a few chances on some players.
Quite clearly that a guy named Nick Belmonte was the first player that I recruited here at the University of Florida.
What were you thinking there?
That was a big mistake. I've gone downhill ever since that time.
You bounced back nicely, though.
Oh, yeah.
He made a great recovery after that recruiting of Mr. Belmonte.
I remember going to his house on a recruiting visit, and Jay Jr., who now is a successful coach in his own right, was just a little kid and sitting around playing with his I think he some kind of baseball game. Everybody grows up. That's what happens. Hey, when I saw little Jay playing for University of Central Florida years later, I said, man, am I getting old. You were just a little guy when I was in Florida.
Now, is it true that they had to slope the outfield up to let you know that you were getting close?
Oh, yeah, we had that Crosley Field, left field, when I was here, and that was an adventure.
A little
as
terrace,
if,
huh?
As if I needed that.
Matt Goss is now in center field for the Gators. And Greg Catalanotti has moved over to right field. A couple of outfield changes for Andy Lopez's team. Nystrom is out of the game after, of course, he was taken down for Siegel, who batted the last inning.
So yeah. Gossel hit in the four spot.
Two balls, two strikes. There's a ball hit to the gap, right center field. Meath getting extra bases on this one, has his eyes on two and will stay right there. A double for Meath. Nick, I'm wondering now about the weekend rotation, what with Rodriguez now throwing 67 pitches and has been the last couple of weeks the Saturday starter. Will he come back on a Saturday, or going deeper into tonight's game, will they push him back to Sunday? It'll be the question we'll find out perhaps tomorrow.
Let's see how everybody feels after tonight's game, and that's going to probably tell a lot on where the rotation goes. Luckily, this being a Tuesday night game, not a Wednesday night game, gives Andy an extra day to make that decision.
And Rodriguez made just 105 pitches, and as everybody has seen here, he's pitched the last four innings. He doesn't put a lot of strain on the arm with his delivery, the way
he
pitches.
No, absolutely not. He can be a little bit more resilient.
One ball, one strike. Batille has two hits tonight for UCF.
However, I've heard pitchers say, well, it doesn't matter that I don't throw that hard. I'm throwing as hard as I can throw.
It's all relative, isn't it?
Yeah, no kidding.
Down in the Florida bullpen, Cardozo still warming up, as now Andy Lopez comes out of the dugout. That was the 70th pitch by Rodriguez, and they may have just decided that 70 was his top end. We'll see. Gators are leading at 7-3 here in the top of the seventh inning. That's Cardozo throwing to Matt Heath down in the Florida bullpen. Rodriguez is going to be allowed to continue. Came on with nobody out in the third in relief of the starter, Derek Devon.
Well, I know that, you know, Andy would like to see him get through all these lefties.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with Batille and Bowser and Brisson, he can get through those three, then maybe he brings in Cardozo. That's what he said, can you give me three more hitters here?
Ball slicing to left. Base hit. Runners on the corners. Ninth hit of the game for Central Florida. And they got runners at first and third with nobody out.
Ball fielder, number 13, Matt Bowser.
Now here's Matt Bowser. Boy, Bowser walked and scored a run. He singled. Narrowly missed another single last time up when he lined Sheely at first, caught it and stepped on the bag for a double play.
And Sergio out there on guts right now, just going up against the next two lefties in the lineup.
Oh, a big cut there on the fielder.
Okay, so he's down right where he wants him here. Lefty, lefty, 0-2 count. This is why he was left in. No pun intended. You can see he really pulled his shoulder in the head.
Here's the 0-2 pitch.
From a fastball away, a pitch that he got Brisson on.
back in the third inning. He was ahead of the count with a sweeping breaking ball. See if he comes into something of that nature here.
Line drive, nearly got another double play.
Oh, my. Battier just got back ahead of the foot of Sheila. And that is one out. This wasn't hit as hard as Bowser's previous ball there.
No, it wasn't, but he got him a little bit in on the hands with it. Sheila in a perfect spot, almost gets them another three unassisted double play.
Dustin Brisson, the batter. Talking to Andy in the dugout before the Sunday game at Starkville, Nick, and we looked at Sergio, and he was having a good time. And I mentioned that to Andy, and Andy said, you know, Whitey Herzog once said, the best thing in baseball is to be yesterday's winning pitcher.
Oh, that is definitely true. If you're yesterday's winning pitcher, you can't wait to get up the next morning. You got the day off, you did your job, you got like four more days or three more days. Okay, you're living large.
And that was Sergio on Sunday. I saw him yesterday, came by my office yesterday. I was talking with him. He said, I could have pitched Sunday. I told Coach, I could have pitched an inning or two on Sunday.
Yeah, let's not overdo it. Come on.
That's what I said.
Yeah, I guess he was still feeling good into the week, huh? All right.
The 0-2 pitch.
Well, if he gets out of this inning, expect a visit tomorrow.
I may have to call him. Come on over. Check the runners now. That's Meath at third, Battier at first. Gators leading 7-3 with one out in the top of the seventh inning. Just off the end of the bat.
Another job of the yesterday's starter is to work the bucket in batting practice. Mm-hmm. So you have to work the bucket behind the screen during batting practice. And you do it with a lot more alacrity when you win the day before.
I haven't done a whole lot with alacrity.
That's not what I heard.
How do you spell that anyway? I'm going to look that up in Funk and Wagnalls. Runner at third, Meath. Runner at first, Battier. 1-2 pitch. Just foul past the first base bag.
Where just a couple of inches right there, and you might have a 7-5 ball game with the tie and run come to the plate.
Mm-hmm. And this could be the last guy Rodriguez faces.
I think you're right. I think he makes the move even if he gets him out here.
Popped him up. Runner at third is tagging. Cat Lenotti makes a throw that Sheely will cut. Sacrifice fly for Brisson. It's now 7-4 and two out. That's the third run batted in tonight for Brisson.
See what Andy decides to do here now that he got the second out. Now they're back to the right-handed hitters in the lineup. I think he makes the move here. And here he is.
Boy, what a job again by Rodriguez. He's going to be in position to win two games in 4 days. He's going 6 2/3 as a starter to win Saturday. And tonight, 4 2/3 in relief. He's in position to win it. We'll tell you about the new Gator pitcher coming in when we return in just a moment.
Can't miss Baseball Thursday. East meets West in an AL showdown. Bo Vaughn powers the Hungry Halos against Derek Jeter and the world champion Yanks. Can't miss Baseball Thursday on Sunshine.
They're the
number one seed in the East, and it's payback time for Miami. Round one is underway, and the Heat are hoping for a Knicks knockout. Game three of the playoffs. Coverage begins Wednesday at 7:30 on Sunshine.
Well, you can tune in to Sunshine Network Live. It's Florida's newest sports call-in show, weeknights at 10, for the first look at scores and highlights, as well as a chance to voice your opinion. Sunshine Network Live, weeknights at 10, only on Sunshine Network. Now, Rodriguez made 81 pitches tonight, going 4 2/3 innings. 6 hits, 2 runs, 1 earned run, walked, 1 struck out, 3. And there's the numbers, Nick, on Jeff Cardozo.
Jeff versatile this year in a sense that he started and he's relieved. And his best pitching has really been coming on the road. You can see 62 2/3 innings, 81 hits, 20 walks, 54 strikeouts. And Jeff, at times looks unhittable. In fact, against Mississippi State, he pitched a pretty good ball game, didn't get out of the fifth, but had some hard luck and some bad breaks, but for the most part, pitched pretty good. Look at that. See, people do keep score. Yeah. Must be for a class project.
And Sergio Rodriguez. Again, 4 2/3 innings tonight.
Great job, Sergio.
One earned run.
Yeah, that's the important stat.
So now Jeff Cardozo. This ball hit well. Center fielder Goss can't come up with it. It's going to go to the gap. Battier being waved in will score easily. And now a 7-5 game. Gavilan with his first hit and run batted in. Rather rude greeting.
Yeah, you're darned if you do and you're darned if you don't if you're a coach, because Andy's, he's figuring, hey, I'm going to get the righty in against the righty. I get the matchup, and the guy hits a double on the first pitch. It looked like Goss took a funny angle on that ball when it was hit, but it was hit well. He just kept the hands back and waited on it. At first, it looked like Goss came in a little bit, but the ball was hit well. I don't think Matt had a chance of catching it.
Well, a left-handed pinch hitter coming up now for UCF. Bill Oakley, hitting 277, has a home run, 15 runs batted in. He represents the tying run. As the Gator lead now cut to 7-5. Two outs here in the seventh inning. There's a base hit to left. Here, the runner is going to be held at third base. And runners on the corner, so Cardozo gives up double single to start it.
Well, there's nothing Jay Bourbon could have done right there. The ball is hit through the hole, and Dill charged it nicely. It really wasn't a whole lot, but to hold his runner up. Of course, that run still doesn't tie the ball game, so it really doesn't mean anything. But he goes with it nice, as you can see. Ball's up, belt high. Just tries to go with it. Nice job. Nice job of pinch hitting coming into the ball game, having a plan, seeing a pitch that he liked and going with it. And then Andy's shaking his head, like I was saying. You're darn if you do. You're Andy, of course, makes the right move. He gets his lefty out there going as far as he can go through the lefties that are in lineup. Then you bring in the righty, and he gives up a double off the fence and a base hit to left.
Now Jeremy Frost, the hitter. Runners on the corners with two out. Well, I think on both those hits, Cardozo left the ball up in the zone. And that's where he got hurt.
Yeah. Now Andy's got to, go with Grzelowski and get him up and throwing. There's Ben there. And that's a design play right there. He just wanted him to
eat up some time. Andy going ahead. He's already made the call.
Well, Ben Greslovsky going to give it a go here. This will be interesting to see. He needs seven outs. And being hit on the elbow before Sunday's game during batting practice, he had looked like two or three baseballs attached to his elbow when they iced it up. And there was concern that his injury was of the very serious nature. But here he is coming back just 2 days later. Cardozo was running off the field when Randy Harvey stopped him to have a little talk with him.
Exchanging pleasantries.
Number 46, Ben Greslovsky.
So Ben Greslovsky coming in for the Gators.
You know, in my opinion, this guy right here is the MVP of the Florida Gators in 1999. I mean, what he has done. 34 appearances. This is appearance 34. 9 wins, 5 losses, 5 saves. I don't know how many holds he's had. ERA, you know, 1.71, which is in the top 10 in the United States. 73 2/3 innings, only 14 runs, only 59 hits, 30 walks, and 75 strikeouts. And the durability of this guy has been phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal.
He's allowed just 2 earned runs over his last 8 appearances. That covers 22 innings and computes to a 0.82 ERA. And Greslovsky, he could become the third Gator pitcher in the last 4 years to lead the league in earned run average, as Rigdon did it in 96, and of course Fogg last year, and Greslovsky in position to accomplish it this year. Well, the Gators will wrap up the season this weekend against Alabama. Friday night at 7, again, we'll remind you that it's Fan Appreciation Night, and the fans can register to win a 2000 Gator Baseball season pass, Gator Baseball cap, and a Gator Baseball jersey. Saturday's game is at 3 o'clock, and the Sunday finale will start at 1:30. For tickets, call 1-800-34-GATOR. By the way, we'll have Gator Baseball for you this weekend on Sunshine Network. On Friday night, as Nick and Nick at Night will make their final appearance this year. And then on Sunshine, you'll see the SEC game of the week on Saturday. Oh, there we are. Maybe cleaned up a little bit there. Hey, we got our new shirts, though. Got those on. Those are nice.
Yeah, I thank Kristen Miller down at the headquarters in Orlando for getting us up.
We got that going for us. That's a nice thing. Keith Walsh. He is batting now. And he fouls it off. Walsh is hitting 145. His first plate appearance of the ball game. Has hit one home run. 11 runs batted in. Gators got 2 runs in the bottom of the 6th, but the Knights have answered with 2 runs in the 7th, and they got men on the corners.
I'm sure when you get a bruise like that on your arm, and you just got it Sunday, every time you throw a pitch as hard as he's been throwing, I mean, it's as hard as he can throw, that is going to hurt. You're going to feel the pain.
Goes the runner, they're going to concede that. Well, now a hit could possibly tie the score. Last week, before the injury, Greslovsky was clocked at 91 miles per hour in a game. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 out, 2 on, 2 in, and there's the base hit to left field. Gavilan will score. They're waving home Oakley. Here comes Dill's throw to the plate. It's a good one. Here's the tag, and he is going to be out at home on a fine throw by Dill. The final out of the 7th inning. The get three runs on five hits, no errors, and one man left. Seventh inning stretch, and the Gators now protecting a one-run lead.
Is your car still running bad? Well, don't get mad. Get MotorUp, the no-oil change engine treatment for a smoother, quieter, and cooler running car. Over 3 million people have already added MotorUp to their automobiles, and now you can too with our special 30-day free trial offer. Just call the number on your screen and tell the operator that you want to try MotorUp before you buy it. This is a unique opportunity for anyone who's never tried MotorUp to try it now risk-free. It's so easy. Just add one bottle to your car's engine and you'll see, feel, and hear a difference almost immediately.
Without a doubt, it's definitely running cooler.
And it's running quieter.
It doesn't shake at all. Look at it.
It's definitely running smoother.
Use MotorUp and you'll get the same amazing results. And because you don't have to change your oil to add MotorUp, you'll save time and money. Before you spend more on costly repairs, call this number now. Put MotorUp to the test and see for yourself. This incredible 30-day free trial offer won't last long. So call now.
With Nick Belmonte, Mick Hubert back at the ballpark. Gators leading 7-6, maintaining the lead because of this play by Dill.
Great play by Dill. The throw is on the money, but you see Johannes set up inside the foul line. So with Bill Oakley, it looked like a little bit of a wide turn. What he needs to do once he sees the catcher open, set up inside like that, is take it another 5 feet outside and just slide by the base and just swipe at it with your left hand. If he does that, Johannes doesn't have the time to go around and chase him. He catches it and he turns around and the catcher's not mobile enough.
Well, this game is now in the hands of perhaps the two best bullpenners as the closer for UCF. Jason Arnold now working a tight game. He came in, the game was a little bit wider margin, but now it's 7-6. In the last of the seventh, and Mike Floyd at bat for Florida.
And in that play of sending Oakley, Bergman has to send him. That's the tie-in run with two outs, and you got to make the opposition give you a perfect throw, and the throw was good, but the fact that Johannes was set up inside, that's when I thought Oakley should have adjusted his slide.
Floyd hits a high fly into center. And the catch made by Battier. Matt Meads is now in right field for UCF. Keith Walsh, who pinch hit, will stay in the game and play second base.
Yeah, he's the transfer from NC State.
Now here's Taylor Wood. It's a high fly ball deep to left, but it is curving, and it will be a foul ball.
Oh, he just missed.
Now Wood hit a game-winning home run, his first in his career, doing it on a Friday night a couple of weeks ago at Vanderbilt. And the Gators beat Vanderbilt 5-4 thanks to Wood's solo home run in the ninth inning.
And we were talking last inning when Arnold came in this ball game, the fact that he can throw up to 94 miles an hour and he has not been drafted.
Called strike. 0-2.
Because we don't know what he was throwing out of high school, but that body, 6'3", 190. There's a high ceiling when you look at what you can work with there. Sure wouldn't throw him too far below that. But maybe he just matured in the last year. This is his second year in Central Florida. So if you're talking to Ben Grzlowski, who was clocked as high as he said 91 last weekend, and you know Ben traditionally, you know, starting into the program didn't throw that hard.
Hard hit ball. Gabaldon stayed in front of it. Throws him out.
Nice play right there. I mean, you know, just keep the ball in front of you, and you can make the play. Everything doesn't have to be fielded cleanly, especially at the so-called hot corner. Just knock it down.
Yeah, you keep it in front of you, you got a lot of time there. It gets down to you in a hurry.
Well, Taylor Wood, I mean, he smokes this ball down there, but watch Gavilan. Stays and keeps it in front of him. Doesn't get too excited. Picks it up, makes the play.
Here's Todd Johannes. Swung right through it. He has two hits tonight. Central Florida has out-hit the Gators now, 12-10. Tell you, Arnold is tough. He has retired all five Gator hitters since he came on.
Arnold has been their closer, but we talked about the importance of this game. Jay Berman's going to stretch him out a little bit here.
Struck him out looking. Boy, six up and six down the last two innings against Arnold. We go to the eighth. It's the Gators 7 and the Golden Knights 6.
Do your closets look like this? Your clothes are wrinkled and ruined. You need Magic Hangers, the amazing space-saving solution that doubles, even triples closet space in seconds. Just place each side of the Magic Hanger on any closet rod, then hang your garments. Unhook one side, and like magic, you've saved over 1 foot of closet space. All your clothes stay wrinkle-free. Magic Hangers are perfect for coats, suits, trousers, all your clothes. They'll even hold 30 pounds of heavy sweaters. It's like adding a whole new closet to your home. Off-season storage stays wrinkle-free. Now you can order a set of 20 Magic Hangers for just $14.80. That's enough Magic Hangers to hold 100 garments. But wait, order now, and we'll include this bonus tie rack. Keeps 48 ties wrinkle-free. Turn this into this with Magic Hangers. So order now.
To order your Magic Hangers for $14.80 plus shipping, have your credit card ready and call 1-800-582-5333. That's 1-800-582-5333. Call now.
Well, the seven-inning total, 7-10-2 for the Gators, 6-12-4 for the Golden Knights. As we move to the top of the eighth inning here, a couple of happy Gator fans. And there's some
the parade wave.
Yeah, so they have that down. There's some happy Magic fans tonight, too, because Orlando beat Philadelphia, leaving the series at 1-1. Well, Ben Greslowski going to start the eighth inning. Came on and faced one batter, Walsh, who singled, but Dill's throw to the plate gunned down Oakley for the final out and kept the score at present 7-6. So we'll see if Greslowski responds here to start a fresh inning. Mike Fox, 271 batter. 1-for-3 in the game. Devon started tonight, went two innings. Then Rodriguez, 4 2/3. Cardozo faced two hitters, both got hits. Greslowski now the fourth pitcher. One the count. There's your final score, the Magic winning 79-68. 2-2.
See if Grizz goes with the slider. See if we can get him to chase it. Started out outer third. See if he'll bite. Oh. That's some bite to it. Actually started that inner third, and it busted right over the plate. Watch this. This inner third looks like it's going to be a ball to the hitter. Mm-hmm. Just totally freezes Fox.
You see that left knee?
Yeah, that's the jelly leg right there. There it is. That's what they call it. That'll give you the jelly leg.
Catcher Brent Spooner now. 1-for-3 tonight. He singled in the fourth inning. Hitting 302. Spooner was hitting 317 last week. A little tailspin, so he was happy to get that hit in the fourth inning. Division of Transamerica Athletic Conference. Last year they had a school record, 66 home runs. Well, there's a walk to Spooner, one out. And now the top of the batting order is coming up.
I
wonder how much pain Grislowski's in.
Gator bullpen has some action in it. There's Alex Hart, Sunday starter. He went 4 2/3 innings at Mississippi State. Meath tonight has one hit. He got it last inning when he doubled, came around to score a run that inning also. They got three runs in the seventh. Strike one. Bouncing ball. Wood, tough angle, and they're going to be saved. That ball was kind of swirling around out there. Wood had to hustle and then made a throw to Canales, who dropped it. And runners at first and second.
Trying to score the fielder's choice. An error to Canales, who obviously, as you can see on the replay, had it in his glove. He just missed it.
That's the second error on Canales, and the Gators' third error of the game. A jam now, runners at first and second, one out. Battier, the hitter.
Try and run now at second base. There's the elbow right there. And it was hit with the bat during batting practice. But no noticeable signs.
Battier with three hits in the game. Oh, it's a tough play. Grislowski off the mound. Good throw and got him at first base. Runners have advanced. Meath to third and Spooner. Rather a Spooner to third base and Meath at second.
Grizz has to wait for this ball to come down. He has to get himself in good fielding position going towards first base. And you can see how close that came. And it came out of Shealy's glove, but they ruled it as he was taking it out after the catch.
Now two out. Tying run at third, lead run at second. Matt Bowser, the hitter.
Well, you got Bowser hitting 387, your Hassan hitting 400, so choose your poison here if you're Andy Lopez with the base open at first.
Yeah. 7-3 after six innings, but the Knights got two in the seventh, or rather a three in the seventh, and threatening to score here in the eighth inning. There's a ball hit to right field, way back, and it's going to be up against the fence. Spooner in, Meath in, and Central Florida has taken the lead. It's 8-7 as Bowser booms a double into right center field.
Usually the matchup you don't want to have is a sidearm against a left-handed hitter, but you can see he kind of goes down there and gets it. Almost one hand flicks it out there to left center field. Shows you how strong Bowser is.
Now five straight runs over the last two innings. Brisson will be intentionally walked with Gabel on, a right-hand hitter on deck. And Nick, it's obvious that this is not the best Greslowski, the injury and all.
No, he's taking one for the team here. I'm sure he's in pain, and I'm sure he's told Andy that he could go out there and perform, but this is not the Greslowski we have seen in the past. And we know why. I mean, it's not often that you take one in the elbow and try to come back in 2 days, but I'm sure he's assured everyone that he's fine. But once you get out there and you actually get in a game, it's a whole different animal.
So there's the intentional walk to Brisson. That puts runners at first and second. Here's Pete Gabelon, Gator coaching staff. Now know they've got to catch up. Looking ahead to the bottom of the eighth, it'll be Canales scheduled up in the top of the batting order, Keene and Catalanotti. Gabelon hit the first pitch from Cardozo in the seventh for a double, which drove home a run. It was his only hit of the game, going 1-for-4. Hitting 286 on the season. Canales at shortstop fires to first to retire the side, but the Knights have gone in front. They get two runs in the inning. They do it on just one hit. Gators trailing now 8-7.
Is your car still running bad? Well, don't get mad. Get Motor Up, the no oil change engine treatment for a smoother, quieter, and cooler running car. Over 3 million people have already added Motor Up to their automobiles, and now you can too with our special 30-day free trial offer. Just call the number on your screen and tell the operator that you want to try Motor Up before you buy it. This is a unique opportunity for anyone who's never tried Motor Up to try it now risk-free. It's so easy. Just add one bottle to your car's engine and you'll see, feel, and hear a difference almost immediately.
Without a doubt, it's definitely running cooler.
And it's running quieter.
It doesn't shake at all. Look at it.
It's definitely running smoother.
Use Motor Up and you'll get the same amazing results. And because you don't have to change your oil to add Motor Up, you'll save time and money. Before you spend more on costly repairs, call this number now. Put Motor Up to the test and see for yourself. This incredible 30-day free trial offer won't last long. So call now.
The eighth inning now, and the Gators trying to catch up. They're trailing at 8-7, having surrendered a 7-3 lead over the last couple of innings. And Canales, Keene, and Catalanotti. And right now, they're all the momentum, as well as the lead, of course, with UCF. And the closer, Jason Arnold, Nick, has faced six Gator hitters, and they have no hits so far.
And he's been in command since he's come on. The Gators only have two more shots to figure him out. Gabelon playing a step in front of the base at third, expecting a bunt.
And strike one.
Doesn't mean you can't bunt with one strike. Sometimes it's a good time to lay one down. You can get it in the right spot. It doesn't matter if they know it's coming or not. They'll still have a tough time with it.
Breaking ball, strike two.
Now, of course, Gavin backs off at third.
Three pitches on a strikeout.
Breaking ball, fastball.
Now here's Kurt Keene with a perfect 4-for-4 performance. Three singles and a double.
It's not what you've done for me lately, but I hate to say it, the Gators need another hit here, so. Four's not going to be good enough, Kurt.
Tonight for Keene, 22 base hits over the last 51 at-bats. Now hitting 309. Look out, boy, drilled him. Didn't want to, of course. He puts the tying run on base. Right in the number five.
That's the correct way to turn away from a pitch. Turn your right-handed hitter, turn your right. That way, hitching the back and things for a little bit.
Jay Bergman now going out to the mound. Make sure he can settle down Arnold.
And remind him where not to throw the ball to Catalanotti.
Mm-hmm. Oh, he's got Catalanotti and Dill coming up. He's made 28 pitches since he came in the game.
Things didn't look good for UCF around the sixth inning. They fell behind by a score of 7-3. And they hit the Gators with a three spot in the seventh and a two spot in the eighth.
Four runs batted in tonight for Catalanotti, a team best 55 on the year. Having earlier tonight hit his team leading 17th home run.
Arnold breezing along, opens the door a little bit here with the one out beating of Kurt Keene. See if the Gators can pry it open a little more. Oh, let's go ahead and hit it. I'm going to throw it as hard as I can. Same thing. So he's got him vulnerable here on two fastballs about letter to shoulder high. Let's see if he goes up the ladder a little more or he tries to get him off speed. But if he goes off speed, he better be off the plate.
Catalanotti misses on this one. Hits a high fly ball. Meath and Wright will make the catch. Just got under it a little bit too much. And so now two out. Jason Dill coming up. Seven home runs, 28 runs batted in, hitting at 311.
Almost got him.
tonight is 1-for-4. He singled leading off the third inning. Another high fly ball. Bowser in left. Got it. And so, the inning over. We go to the ninth inning at Central Florida 8 and the Gators 7.
And don't come back until you...
We remember that moment in our lifetimes when we reached out and had that first discovery and said, my God, it is possible. If I work hard, I can walk in this intellectual area where no one has been before. And that moment is the transforming moment that captures the best graduate students, that captures the best faculty members, and translates it into the quality that energizes this university.
They're the number one seed in the East, and it's payback time for Miami. Round one is underway, and the Heat are hoping for a Knicks knockout. Game three of the playoffs. Coverage begins Wednesday at 7:30 on Sunshine. It's arena football. A 50-yard indoor war filled with high-scoring, heart-stopping, helmet-popping, in-your-face football. It's wall-to-wall action, and Sunshine Network takes you to the center of it all. The Bobcats battle the Storm Saturday at 7:30 on Sunshine.
With Nick Belmonte, Mick Hubert back at the ballpark. We go to the ninth inning now, and the Gators are trailing it 8-7. And for the Knights, here in the top of the ninth inning, they'll send up Bill Oakley to lead it off against right-hander Ben Greslowski. Oakley singled in the seventh inning. He got his base hit off Cardozo, batting .284 in the year. Northeast Louisiana and LSU are tied 4-4 in the seventh inning.
Greslowski did run into some problems last inning, but none of the runs he gave up were earned due to the error by Canella.
Two balls, one strike. Ball, Canales gloving it, back of the bag. Throws him out.
Good play by Josh going to his left. You got to play like that, a decent guy running. You got to make, you can't make any excess motion. You got to come through clean and make a play.
Here's Keith Walsh. He also had a hit. Sends a fly ball deep to left field, but plenty of room there for Dill. So quickly, two Knights out here in the ninth inning. Looking ahead to the bottom of the ninth inning for the Gators.
Mike Fox,
Matt Goss, Ryan Sheely, and Mike Floyd. It's the middle of the batting order scheduled up. Now here's Mike Fox. 1-for-4 in the game. Showing bunt.
He's chilling bunt here. He's 0-for-2 in stolen bases on the year. Unless he really thinks he's really leaving it up to Spooner for an extra base hit. It's his job to get down to second base via the extra base hit.
Swung right over the top of it. 2-1 now.
Now, all that being said, that has to do, of course, with two outs, nobody on. Had a might not have been that situation, then it's not a bad play.
Ball three and strike one to Mike Fox. Two out with nobody on base. Chased ball four there. Two and one, or rather, three and two the count.
Andy would like to see Ben getting out right here on this pitch and not have to use any more pitches.
Ground ball, right side. Wood can't come up with it. The ball jumped over his glove. I don't know if he could have gotten over there any quicker or not. The ball was hit rather sharply.
Yeah, it was a tough chance mm-hmm. right here. And he hits off the end of his glove. But he was still about two, three steps in the outfield.
Hit number 14 tonight for Central Florida. They hit just 291 in the Mercer series. Well, a good night tonight. First ball swinging, Spooner sends it foul on the first base side.
In Wood Bet Baseball World, 291 is not too bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're hitting 318 for the season. That's the second highest season batting average at UCF. They're scoring 8.3 runs a game, and they're right there right now. Leading at 8-7 here in the ninth inning. This would be quite a comeback win for them. They trailed 7-3 going to the seventh inning. Ground ball to Wood. And he makes the tag at second base, and that's it. One hit, no runs, and one man left. Bottom of the ninth, Gators have won seven games in their final at-bat, trailing by a run.
Are you living in the dark ages using dangerous sharp knives? Well, step into the future with the amazing new Rotato, the easiest and safest way to peel fruits and vegetables. Just load the Rotato, adjust the spring-loaded robotic arm, and watch the razor-sharp Kai blade conform to any fruit or vegetable. Spend less time preparing meals and more time enjoying them. It peels potatoes, tomatoes, even kiwis. You'll do apples for applesauce, lemons for lemon zest, exotic fruits like mangoes for healthy fruit salads, and nothing goes to waste. Order now, and you'll also receive this julienne slicer, a $10 value with no extra charge. But if you pick up the phone in the next 10 minutes as a special one-time bonus, the exclusive Tap and Chop is yours free. It makes short work of all your chopping needs. Tap and Chop does onions, herbs, nuts, even ice. You'll receive the Rotato, all the accessories, the julienne maker, and the Tap and Chop, all for just $29.99. Order now.
To order Rotato for only $29.99 plus shipping, call 1-800-738-8448. That's 1-800-738-8448, or send check or money order to the address on your screen.
Bottom half of the ninth inning, Gators trailing 8-7. Big Al trying to get them going. Baseball Al.
As he's done 100,000 times before.
He's the king of the comeback wins. The Gators have seven wins in their final at-bat. Needing one to tie and two to win, Matt Goss is going to make his first plate appearance in the game.
You might want to check that third baseman here and see where he's playing, because many times we said a bunt will break up. We've seen it tonight, a guy rolling right along. Gavilan playing even with the bag at third, now a step out on the grass. Now he backs up.
Really guarding the line, though. You know, in the Sunday game at Starkville, the Gators got beat, and the game got away from them in the seventh inning. Mississippi State scored six runs in the seventh inning. Travis Chapman led off the seventh by laying down a bunt. Here's your ball.
showed it there. I mean, you got a speedy hitter in Goss going from the left side. He's got that extra step towards first base.
This is the fourth inning of relief work for Jason Arnold. And maybe just the thought of him laying it down has rattled out a little.
Because right now what Arnold's trying to do is to concentrate on getting off the mound after he throws it.
Mm-hmm. There was his pitch.
It looked like he was trying to go to right side with that ball.
That's Ryan Sheely due up next. Now you need to make an adjustment. Two strikes. Needing to get on base. Needing base runners.
Good job right there by Goss staying alive. Got to make sure that he fouls off those close pitches. Dig Bergman knows he's three outs away from a victory here, but those always the three toughest. Did the bat go past home plate? That was close. It looked like he just held up in time.
And he walked in. Not even close. Tying run walks to first base, leading off the bottom of the ninth inning.
Now let's see what Annie Lopez decides to do here, because Ryan Sheely is a guy that probably not known for his bunting ability. Let's see if he makes the move, and he is. And it's going to be Mark Ellis.
How about this?
So, Mark, a guy more adept in laying one down here. As we know, Mark has the ability to hit one out and win it all.
He is the all-time Gator leader in sacrifice bunts.
And I'm sure that's why he's been brought in here. They really don't care if he makes it down the line. Of course, after that pitch, I'd love to see another base on balls here. That would make life interesting for all concerned.
Ellis has 20 sack bunts, but can't get it down there.
Hardest pitch to bunt is that high fastball. Ball's probably above his hands. He has to come up and get it. A little poke at it right there.
You're right. Above your hands.
It's easier to bunt that pitch going down than it is going up. Arnold knows that, too.
Now Matt Heath will be the second pinch hitter for the Gators. Heath hitting 293, four home runs, 17 RBI.
Well, he's looking for a pitch he can drive somewhere, preferably out of the park, but he'll settle for hitting it hard in the hole somewhere or gapping it. Goss with good speed at first.
Heath was 2-for-5 with a 2 RBI game Sunday at Mississippi State. 1-for-4 Saturday, included a double. Tying run at first with one out.
Oh, did he just miss that?
Ball one and strike two. Jason Arnold trying to pick up a win in relief for UCF.
Jay Bergman has the center and right fielders playing pretty deep, keeping the ball in front of them. They're in a no doubles mode right here.
Still 1-2.
Jay Bergman. Doesn't get easy. Not supposed to be. Baseball's that way.
Struck him out. It's driven many a coach and manager to the broadcast booth.
And back out of the broadcast booth.
Next inning for Florida. Number 20.
Now two out now. And
that's a nice pitch right there. Right over the top of it.
Well, here's Tony Sakaris, who we identified earlier in the game as another walking wounded. Sakaris with a sprained ankle about 3 weeks ago. He hasn't batted since. Hitting 308, two homers, five RBI.
He does have the ability to send everyone home either way here.
He's missed the last 11 games with that sprained ankle against Kentucky on April 18th.
He does have power. He can catch lightning in a bottle here.
Well, the Gators caught their break here in the bottom of the ninth when the leadoff man walked. Representing the tying run, but he's still down there. Two balls and a strike to Sakaris. Todd Johannes would be next. The 2-1 pitch. Foul back.
You want to be careful if you're Arnold on those throws to first base. You just want to make it a token. I know you're there. Last thing you want to do is throw one away and have the potential tie run go down to scoring position.
Now here it is. 2-2 pitch.
Jay Bergman didn't want to see a 3-2 because right here, Goss is off and running with the pitch, but the fact that he's the tying run, they're going to go ahead and keep him on and keep him close, which is a smart play.
Foul back again.
They play behind Goss here in this situation. He's off and running on the pitch and gets a great jump and possibly could score on a long single. But that's why Brisson, as you can see, is going to keep him there.
Foul tip into the glove, struck him out, ball game over. And Central Florida has rallied from a 7-3 deficit to beat the Gators tonight. The final score, Central Florida 8 and the Gators 7. Nick and I will return right after this.
Next up. Stay tuned to receive your